we're going to start a new sermon series this week on books of 1st and 2nd Chronicles. They are not books that we typically go to very often in the Old Testament. There's anything wrong with them, but they're kind of a retelling of a story that we find elsewhere in Scripture. They're kind of the telling of the story of the people of Israel from about the time that David becomes king until the time where Israel gets kind of flattened in war by the nation called Babylon, and everything goes horribly wrong for the people. And Chronicles, a little different than the first telling. We find some books called 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings. Four books. It's actually one book. It fits in four scrolls in ancient days. Same with Chronicles. It gets divided in half just because it fits better in a book. Doesn't matter. Anyways. 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Samuel, those books, they're being written while history is happening. People are recording what's going on, tells us some stories, they're entertaining. 1 and 2 Chronicles are kind of telling the same story, but later, like quite a bit later, like decades, almost 100 years later. And so with a little bit of perspective, a little bit of understanding of something, and it's predominantly this, why, as we go through these stories, does faith begin to fall apart in the nation? Why does belief get left behind as time is going on? Why does God have to intervene dramatically in history and allow these Babylonians to come along, kind of get everybody's attention again? How is it that people have become focused on the wrong things? And a major theme within this is the Ark of the Covenant and the temple, especially during the times of David and Solomon. Now, the Ark of the Covenant. We know the Ark of the Covenant today. Usually it's, from a movie that came out in the 80s. Everybody knows it from Indiana Jones, right? Yeah, forget the Indiana Jones movies, okay? Not the right... Yeah, doesn't come from the Bible, okay? I promise. The Ark is no longer buried in Egypt. It doesn't make your face melt, all that type of stuff. That's not what it's about. It is actually the throne of God. It's symbolic of being the place of God's majesty, of the place where he would be to prove that he was king. The ark is the throne. The temple is the place where they put the ark, and it is a symbol of the presence of God. It's a building they build in the middle of Jerusalem. It's going to become a major theme as we go through the next few weeks. Not so much today, but in the next few weeks. The temple is a building, and it reminds people that God is with them. Okay, so we've got these two little things to remember. Ark of Covenant, throne of God. Temple, place where God is present. So if everything fell apart, was it a problem that God was no longer present? Was it that maybe they built their faith on some falsehoods? Maybe they had built the whole thing, maybe just even the way they were worshiping. Maybe they were singing the wrong songs and they were offending God. Maybe they were doing things in the wrong way to offend God. Maybe even the way they built the temple was wrong. Were they doing things that instead of bringing worship to God, were bringing... story of building a skyscraper in New York back in the 1930s or 20s or something long time ago. They were building a skyscraper and they were bringing it together, all these girders, and they were all these girders had been ordered and built and were placed in front of where the skyscraper is being built. And the foreman asked some of his workers, go measure them, make sure they're the right height. Came back a little while later to discover that all these cranes have been lifting up these girders and people were on big ladders trying to measure them. He said, why didn't you just leave them on the ground to measure them? And he said, well, you didn't ask us how long they were. You asked us how high they were. No, I'm not sure that has anything to do with it. The point is, were they doing things wrong? Were they doing things wrong? And it's going to set up a very strange story that we first find in 1 Chronicles 13. Now, I'm going to scare you for a minute. Can I scare you? I'm going to look at three chapters today of the Bible. That sounds like it's going to be like a six-hour sermon, doesn't it? I promise I'll try to keep it shorter than that. 1 Corinthians 13, strange story, has to do with a misunderstanding of what worship is. Can you control God? Can you control him? David is the king. He has just finished conquering an area that encompasses the city of Jerusalem. And he looks at the city of Jerusalem. It's a site that has been important earlier in Jewish history. And now he's conquered it. It's a defensible place. It is a great place for a capital. So he decides he's going to move the capital to Jerusalem. They're setting it up. And he gets the people together and says, you all, we've got this Ark of the Covenant. What do you think? Should we move it to the capital? I mean, that makes sense, doesn't it? It could be in our most important new city. And everybody says, yeah, that kind of makes sense. Let's bring it here. It's the Ark of the Covenant. It's the presence of God. Surely, if we bring the presence of God to Jerusalem, God will bless this place. So, it says, okay, we're going to move it on this day. Get everybody together. Get all your best singers together, all your best musicians. We're going to build a brand new cart. That doesn't sound really fancy, does it? But we're going to get a brand new cart. We're going to put the Ark of the Covenant on it. We are going to bring it to Jerusalem. And so they all get there. They worship hard. It says they worship with all of their might. David and everybody else sings hard, and they get all these, it says, they get all this music together. They get lyres and harps and tambourines and cymbals and trumpets, and they sing with all their might. Deafening, it sounds like. They travel along for a little bit. I don't know if they're singing as they're traveling or they just sung as they were sending it off, but whatever. They're going along, and there's a couple of guys who've been tasked with driving the cart. And I don't know quite how this road was. It must have been in bad shape. I think it was built by the same folks who built 619 here or something like that, because they hit a pothole. Man named Uzzah is the guy who's helping to drive the cart. The ark looks unstable. He reaches up to kind of just, I don't know what he thought he was going to do, because it weighs a lot. I mean, it had gold overlay. But he reaches up just to kind of give it a little bit of stability. You may know this story. He reaches up, he touches the Ark of the Covenant, he falls down dead. Now, the Ark is not like it's portrayed in Indiana Jones. This is, however, where they get the idea. It just happens once, I promise. He reaches up, he touches it, he falls over dead. It says in the text that David, the king, is really, really angry with God for this. And as he continues to think about it, he suddenly, his anger starts to turn to fear. God is not happy. God is not going to bless us if we don't get the ark to Jerusalem. But what am I supposed to do about it? So they go and they see a house nearby, and they go and they knock on the door and say, can we leave the ark here for a little while? And they leave it at a house, and the name of the guy isn't important for anything other than the fact, I think it's a really cool name to say. His name is Obed-Edom the Gittite. I mean, isn't that a fun name to say, Obed-Edom the Gittite? Yeah, some of you are saying that, I can see it. The ark stays here for a couple months while David tries to figure out what he is going to do. I have some thoughts on this first part of the story. The first one is David and all of Israel had some good intentions. But David is looking, and this isn't bad, he's looking for things to go well in his reign, his life, his kingdom. Good thing. So he wants the ark. He wants this reminder that God is king. And if he brings this reminder, this symbol, to Jerusalem in his mind, he's thinking, I'm going to have good luck. Yeah, basically, I'm going to have good luck. Because God has to bless the place where he resides, right? Isn't after worship. Isn't after anything but this. If he does this, he can flatter God. He's honoring God. And because he flatters God with the words that he is singing, with bringing the ark to this place, if God is flattered, he will do what he's told. You make God do what he's told. This doesn't sound quite right, does it? Flatter God, make him do what is right. He's trying to bring prestige a little bit to his kingdom. We're told in this chapter that unlike his predecessor Saul, at least David appreciates the ark and he goes and he talks to God. And he's saying to himself, I know what God wants, I know how to please him. I can prove myself compared to the failures of the previous generation. He's in the early stages of faith, but at the bottom line is, he is using God for his own success. And basically, the rug gets pulled out from under him. God is saying, who is in control? Who is in control? We cannot control God. He's rejecting him because David went to the people. The people say this seems right in their eyes. Then we can worship God in such a way that will bring success to Jerusalem. And David is also looking and saying, you know what? All the people are going to be looking to me. They're going to see that I love God. They're going to see what a righteous man I am. It's not bringing glory to God. It's bringing glory to himself. And God rejects this flattery. For a period, David walks away from the ark, angry and afraid, because God is not acting like he thinks he should act. We skip a chapter. We're going to skip over chapter 14. Story. It's a gory story. It's a lot more. David finally comes back to this idea of the ark. And he starts to give worship some structure to bring joy and hope. See, several months pass. There's no direct answer for God of what to do. God doesn't always give us the answers that we seek right away. He does not always answer our prayers immediately because sometimes he is trying to teach us humility and he is trying to teach us patience. And that is okay. God's in control. But David does eventually get what he answered. Do you know how he finally figures out what the answer is for God? He finally gets an answer from God. Do you know how he does it? Do you think it's that God says something dramatic from the heavens? That God sends a prophet to tell him what to do? When he gets smart, he looks in his Bible. He opens the Word of God. And he finds the answer there. That this wasn't the way in which he was supposed to move the Ark of the Covenant. He looks into the Word of God and he hears from the people. And he asks the question, how do I approach God? If this is symbolic of the place where God is, how do I approach God? And he realizes he's been doing it wrong. He's not supposed to do it at all. God has set apart people. They're called the Levite. They're supposed to do this. They're not just supposed to sit on a cart. They're supposed to put it on a special board. It's not so much about, however, how he's doing it. As much as this, he's trying to do it in a way that doesn't bring glory to himself, but brings glory to God. So they try to stick a little closer to work. They go up to Obed-Edom, the Gittite's house. They knock on the door and say, okay, thanks for looking after the ark. Thanks for all your hospitality. We'll take it from here. And they go not with fear or anger, but according to the scriptures, they go with joy. They go with joy. They've got their hearts right with God. They go with the same, it lists all the instruments again, they go with the same instruments, they go with all the same loud music. That's not the point. It's not about style, but they do a lot differently because they start with humility. And there's some great lessons in this. It even says that David danced the whole way. Now, when we were doing music practice, I asked if Danny would dance through the whole music, and I figured his family would die of embarrassment. No, we're not going to do that. But David did dance the whole way to Jerusalem. What is different here? David is humble. And humility is developed. And David recognizes it's not about him. It's not about flattering God. It's something deeper. The people gather themselves together, all these Levites, all these singers. One of the big differences between the two chapters is they prepare themselves. It doesn't go into a lot of detail what it means to prepare themselves, but they prepare themselves to worship. They don't just show up and expect everything to go well. I think they spend time in prayer first. Coming towards God before they start singing, they pray. Did you pray this morning before I came to worship? Did you ask God to teach you through this word, through the songs? Did you ask God to prepare your hearts for what he would give you this morning? Do you believe God has something for you this morning? Do you think God can teach you through music? Or is it just, I'll come and I'll sing and try to flatter God a little bit and try to get him to bless me because I flatter him? Or you think God wants to teach you something today? They prepared themselves for worship. They did it with joy. They did it with rejoicing. Overall, they recognized as they were doing this, maybe we'll do it God's way because God is not like us. God is, and there's the fancy word we use in theology, he's holy. He's not like you and I. And they recognize that. And they learn about God in this. So instead of flattery, they come with humility. They have come having prepared their hearts. And maybe most importantly in all, in that holiness, they've recognized the truth about the relationship between them and God, that God is this great, majestic, eternal being beyond us. And I'm mean. And I'm just loved by God, and I'm just showing up because God loves me. Beginning the next chapter, at the very end of it, it says this, then he appointed some of the Levites as ministers before the ark of the Lord to invoke. That's a fancy word meaning to kind of commemorate, to remember, to discuss what God has done, to thank, to say thank you to God for the things he's done, and to praise the Lord. And the clear indication of that word praise is it has to do with singing. The remembering that we prize our relationship with God. We should prize that relationship. So in all this, David is learning some powerful lessons about how to worship. He's learning a little bit about humility, because that's part of it. He's learning he has to prepare his heart. He's learning to recognize the relationship that he has with God in all this. I skip one little piece of the story. One little verse. It's actually not very long. Maybe it's too short. I don't remember. Very end of chapter 15. said David danced the whole way. Said Dan, we didn't have Danny do that because he embarrassed his family. David embarrassed his family. His wife is very angry with him. That's not dignified. You don't look like a king at this moment. You don't look royal and regal. And she wanted a husband who was royal and regal, and she could take pride in the fact that she was married to the king. And she's quite mad at him. Maybe that's another lesson about worship. If you're doing it right, somebody's going to be mad at you. Because there is an enemy who does not want worship to happen. And it's going to change the focus that it's all about the performance. It's all about something like that. It's all about how it sounded. Because it's not. Even somebody who sings like me can worship God. It's really mad at him. Maybe that's part of it too. Because I'm going to tell you, Satan will be mad if we worship God. He then, in the rest of chapter 16, after his wife's mad at him, they finally get the ark, he gets to Jerusalem, they find a place for it. A tent. A tabernacle. A place that God had instructed that this is where the ark was to rest until a temple was built. They put it there until David figures out what he wants to do with the temple. And they sing. They gather once more and they sing. In fact, it talks about worship being a blessing. It's going to end. I'm going to start with the finish, and I'm going to come back to a couple verses real quick. But the end of chapter 16, it says about the blessing, the worship. Now, who's blessed? It's a good question. Do you know who gets blessed from our worship? It's actually God, according to this. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Now, God is the one being blessed. That almost sounds like we're flattering him, doesn't it? Except for this, we need to give a proper understanding of what it means to bless here. It's not just bless you, something like that. There is blessings that we pray over a person for success or something like that. That's not this word. Go to the ancient, understanding this word, it has to do that I am saying that you are Lord, that you are King, and if that is true, I am putting myself under you, and I am transferring power to you. I am giving you power. Worship should give power to God from our lives. It is a form of being obedient. It is saying, because I am singing to you, I am trusting you, I am calling out that you are Lord, and if you are Lord, I will follow you. I will follow you. How do we do that? David starts to learn some very important lessons about why you should yield to him and how he does that. And he sings a song of praise, and he comes to the presence of God joyfully and thankfully, with worship as his goal, with a desire to humbly yield to God. But how does he do that? I'm going to take us to 7 verses real quick. Don't worry, it'll be quick. In this psalm that I think show us how we properly worship God. First one is found in verses 10 and 11. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. We are going to find joy when we find the strength of God, so he says, look for it. Worship should be part of our exploration of how great God is. We learn about God as we sing. We're trying to find his heartbeat. If you verses later. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and his judgments he uttered. Remember. Go back over the things that he has done. Remember the good that God has done in your life. Remember. That's not the only thing we are to remember. Three verses later, in verse 15, he says this, remember his covenant forever, the word that he commanded for 1,000 generations. Worship should lead us to the word of God. Worship should lead us deeper into the Bible. It should teach us about Jesus. And remember his word. Worship proclaims salvation, for great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He's to be feared above all gods. It proclaims God to those who might be worshiping other things. We see feared above all gods in small little g. That can be a lot of things we can end up worshiping. So proclaiming to those who might worship other things, here is our great God. Next verse reads, for all the gods of the people are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Boy, that puts our relationship with God into perspective. It's about discovering that relationship of this God who is the majestic sovereign of everything. Loves little old me. Puts it in perspective. Ascribe to the Lord the glory to his name. Bring an offering and come before him. In all ways it draws us to himself and teaches us to leave the world behind, whether it be through our efforts and singing, financial gifts, or whatever the case may be, we're leaving it behind because it's secondary to Jesus. And the final verse, worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. David, as he's worshiping, is finding his security in God and not the temporary. This is a crazy story. I mean, it sounds simple. We're going to move the ark from this city to Jerusalem. But the Bible spends a huge portion of time talking about, not just in this passage, but throughout the scriptures, talking about how we approach God, why we approach him. I've long said that when we worship God, it is not about God, it is about teaching us. I'd like to amend that a little bit. Worship is about approaching God in prayer, song, an offering, whatever the case may be, in service. However, whatever way we approach God, it is about developing a partnership with him. It's about developing a partnership with him. About finding the Holy Spirit who brings us deeper into his will, deeper into obedience. It's learning to trust the ways of God and go deeper. And over the next few months, we're gonna build a temple up, discover how approachable God is when we have eternal life, and how badly he wants to have a relationship with us. Because as we worship God, we are discovering a God who desperately wants us to know him and desperately wants to walk through life with us. We need to do it, though, the way that he wants. Trust him obediently. So we're going to sing a song to finish off that I think is a response to this. It's hymn number 546 if you want to follow along in the hymn books. Trust and obey.